take someone's hand right next to you and repeat this prayer with me. Precious Holy Spirit, you are my master mentor. You are my trusted teacher. I love your voice. I love your presence. When you speak, I listen. When you correct me, I improve. You have changed me. Today, I am a receiver of uncommon knowledge, uncommon wisdom. Place me in the center of your assignment for me. Amen and amen. Oh, give God a hand clap of praise. I love sitting at your feet. You may be seated. I love hearing what you say. Oh, sing it like a choir. I love knowing your desires. I'm so pleasured to obey. I'm so pleasured to obey. Your favor is like sunrise. Your favor is like sunrise. Driving all my nights away. All my nights away. I love sitting at your feet every single day. I love sitting at your feet every single day. Hold your Bible close to your heart, and I like to have people stroke it like you would stroke the cheek of a child. Just stroke your Bible. Say it aloud, this is my wisdom. Now kiss your Bible. Kiss it again. Stroke it again. Don't you love this word? Now rub it over your face. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hold it up high and say, this is my wisdom. This is our wisdom. Oh, praise God. Praise God. I love this song. It's my favorite song out of all the songs the Lord's put in my heart. I love sitting at your feet. I love hearing what you say. I love knowing your desires. I want us to sing it together again. And you that might be visiting with a friend, you may not know this song. I don't know that you'll even make heaven until you learn this song. St. Peter may keep you outside the gate and said, did you learn Mike's song? Let's sing it again. I love sitting. I love sitting at your feet. I love hearing what you say. I love hearing what you say. I love knowing your desires. I love knowing your desires. I'm so pleasured to obey. I'm so pleasured to obey. Your favor is like sunrise. Your favor is like sunrise. Driving all my nights away. All my nights away. I love sitting at your feet every single day. Yes, yes. I love sitting at your feet every single day. Praise God. take a pen and a sheet of paper, and I want you to write down some special things. And I know that Pastor Linnell and Pastor Monica will be sharing with you in a moment, but I asked them if I could barge in. I said, there's something I want to get off my chest. I get to talk to women. I love sitting at your feet. I love hearing what you say. But I've got to talk to you what I wish women knew about men. And your presence shows that you have realized you don't know enough about men. How many wish you knew more about men? Not all men, but just your man in your life. Turn to Proverbs chapter, and I'm going to be speaking to our men today on a subject that I'm very, very feel like it's just really, really important, and what I wish men knew about money, because money is more important than anybody is admitting. Very important, very important, and it's not enough just to have a financial miracle. You want to have a financial understanding. How many want more than a miracle? You want just financial understanding as well. Turn to Proverbs chapter 4, one of my favorite, the basis of our ministry. And you that are watching, hello, Prophet Marquez. You'll get some good material here today, won't you? I was supposed to have two, we got two. Hello, son, good to see you. All right. Looking over here and here. Somebody gave me a sheet that we decided that there's many people that could not be here, and some live in Brazil. Brazil is watching right now. Canada is watching. Cameroon. Germany. We have a lot of people watching in India. Italy. Gloria, I hope you're watching. Gloria's promised to cook me some good meals when I come to Italy. Mexico. First time I heard everybody say Mexico, I said, wow, God can set you free from that speech impediment. Mexico. I thought, wow, they don't know how to say Mexico. But that's the right way, I guess. Nigeria, Norway, Pakistan. And I hope that Yasmin and her older sister is watching. She's a great young evangelist. She's been, she's like a daughter in the Lord to me. And she texted me late last night and said, Dad, God has opened a door. There's 350 in a village that want me to come teach them the gospel. And she is quite ecstatic. Pakistan, South Africa, and Great Britain, England. We're going to talk today for a few moments on what I wish every woman knew about men. And it's important. It's important because your life is connected to men. One you like, one you hate, one you don't like, but men have become your fascination. You know that, like women are our fascination. And like a little boy up in the mountains, his father, his mother died, and his father said, oh, I don't want to ever let him go through this sorrow, so I don't want to ever let him be around women. So he raised the baby by himself in the mountains, and the boy got 10, 11, 12 years old, and he said, well, we got to find some food. So they went ahead and went a long ways to a little village, and they were walking around and getting food, and the little boy kept staring at women. He had never seen one. And he said, Daddy, what are those? He said, they're geese, son. That's a goose. So just before they went home, he said, Daddy, could we bring one of those geese home with us? It's inside of a man to respond to a woman. When God made that fascination between us and God connected that, I was, when my son Jason was a year and a half old, I was surprised. We always around other babies and other things. And his reaction to little boys, kids, was very different than his reaction to little girls. Real weird. But he would fight, do all kinds of things. But when there was a little girl baby brought up, he reached over and he did like this to a little girl baby. Now, he never did that to a little boy baby. Never did that. How do you know at a year and a half how to stroke the cheek of a woman? But he knew. Sometimes that's not wisdom. Sometimes it's instincts. But God has made that unbelievable attraction between men and women. It's a God thing. It's a God thing. You don't decide it. It's a God thing. When you go through a divorce, you say, I'll never talk to a man again. Men are creeps. Men are full of devils. But it won't be very long until you're delivered. And you say, wow, I want to be around them again. Proverbs 4:7, wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom with all thy getting, get understanding. Wisdom is the ability to recognize difference. Difference in a moment, difference in an environment. Difference in countenance. Difference in people. Difference in an opportunity. Your difference from others. Their difference from you. That's what wisdom is. Discerning difference. Discerning difference. And it's critical that as a woman on the earth, you recognize your own divine difference. Difference in speaking, difference in thinking. And it's like a buffet line. Men are looking at one part of the buffet and you're looking at another part of the buffet, and we both need to exchange what we see. Nobody sees it all. Number one, what I wish women knew about men was timing. Timing. T-I-M-I-N-G. Timing. Timing about what you talk about. Timing how you approach someone. I want to give you a wisdom key that every woman would excel and could excel in, and it would change your impact on men. Every woman wants to have an impact on her man. Some women want to have an impact on, some women want to have an impact on all men. I was very interested in a girl one time that was on my staff. Very interested. She just had a way of looking at me that excited me. When she looked at me, it was like I was the only man on the earth. And every man likes that. Every man likes that. And I liked, she could energize me. She just energized me. And so I had an interest in her. I was watching her, watching how she reacted to people, reacted to various things, because that's the way I read people, by their reactions. Was it an appropriate reaction? And she just, man, I tell you, I thought, and even while I preached, she would just, and she could take notes like nobody's business. She could take notes. She showed me her notes, and she got it. She's smart. She wasn't stupid. Me and my brother, about five or six of us, were going from room to room looking at things. And so we came into a room, and we were looking at things. And I turned around, and my baby brother was behind me. And I went to find, and she was beside him, as excited about him as she had been about me. Oh, like a knife in me. And that's when I realized that was her Delilah stance. Every woman has one, you know. Every woman knows. Most women discern their impact on a man. Not all women, but most do, in my opinion. And when I saw her look, I just, and here I was all interested in this, and she wasn't interested in, she was interested in their giggling. They were both giggling together. And I said afterwards, because he was engaged at the time, I said, you sure you're not going to want to marry her? I said, I saw more excitement on y'all's face than I've seen in a good while. But he didn't end up with her. I guess it was just their moments for excitement. Timing means there is a time to talk to someone about something. Demas Shakarian, the great leader of the Full Gospel Businessmen's Meeting, said never talk to anyone until they are ready to receive it. Until they're ready to receive it. I think it's a flaw in the average woman that she is so focused on what's on her heart that she wants to blurt it out, discuss it, talk it, and she doesn't care who's around, who hears, or even if the man is ready to receive it. There's different reactions. I'm not talking about Tommy Tenney's little baby girl who told her friend, wait till watch me how I ask daddy. He gives me anything I want. Because she knew how to climb up. Just anything. About 8 years old and knew how to climb in his lap and stroke his cheek and kiss him before she asked him something. So that's kind of inherent in a daddy's girl. But I'm talking about when you're older and you're talking to people. And I told my mother one time, who is a phenomenal woman, as smart a human as I've ever met in my life, and in life, how to live life. I said, Mother, you're making a mistake. When Daddy finishes preaching and gets in the car, that's really not the time to discuss the children and who disobeyed and why he did this and why. I said, there's a time for that. There's a time to discuss something with a man. Timing. Who do we know that's like that in Scripture? Obviously, Esther. Naomi taught that to Ruth. Timing. 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 Is this the time? Is this the place? I'm astounded at what people tell me when I walk off of a platform and I'm emptied and my mind and my soul is just so soaked in a message. And I have emptied for an hour and a half. What people start talking to me about when I finish is an IQ photograph. It's an IQ photograph. If someone starts talking to you, it's like your child while you're trying to cook. And you've got this pot of beans or soup and you're trying to carry it. Mama, mama, look at my Crayola. Look, not now, baby. That's how men feel. They're tired, come in from a long day, and you don't know what they've encountered. All you know is they better transition fast when they come through that door. Buster, you're home now, and you've got some responsibilities. Let me say this, that a man easy to control is not a man you want. Assess an environment before you attempt to change it. Assess a situation before you attempt to impact it. I wish women understood that about a man. He won't always show his agitation to you. He'll tell it to his buddies. You'll tell your agitation to him. And your girlfriends. But a man keeps a lot inside. That's the nature of a normal man. Normal man. Timing. Work with timing. There's a phrase that men don't like. I'm one of them. We got to talk sometime. If you come up to me today and say, we got to talk, I'm going to say, we're talking right now. That's what we are doing. We're talking right now. You got something to say? Say it. Say it. Say it. Or shut up about it. Timing. Do you understand timing and how to transition? Esther had a meal with the king. Whatever reason, she sensed the candles were burning. The candles were burning. She was dressed. All is well. But something was off in the timing. This is not the time. This is not the time. There's got to be a bridge. Work with the timing. It was the key to Abigail. Timing. Number two, men want an entertainer. Men want an entertainer. They want to be entertained. Did you know that? Well, they could go to the zoo. No, they don't feel like. They don't feel like going to the zoo. The average man is easily bored. And if he doesn't find what entertains him around him, he climbs up in his mind and entertains himself. But it's important for you to understand that a man has to have that escape room in his life. There's a lot of stress he cannot discuss. There's a lot of stress he cannot discuss. It took me a long time to understand that that was something I needed in my life. Doesn't have to be, doesn't mean you have to sit there and do somersaults all day. Doesn't mean you sit there and have to play a drum for him. But he wants what you say to be interesting. He wants your presence not only to be a nest, but something he enjoys. A man is looking for entertainment. Now, when you see one entertain some men, you realize all men are not the same, which is my next point. But a man doesn't need to be entertained all the time. And what you think is entertaining may not be entertaining. Now, the average woman that I know thinks men are just constantly in a sexual state, looking for something sexy all the time. You may have had that experience with someone starved, someone desperate. But I want to tell you from a man's standpoint, men are not always ready. Men are not always ready. And you must assess that. Now, you know how it is when you're not ready to be loved and the man comes around nuzzling, nuzzling, nuzzling right in the middle of your work and you're agitated, right? Did you know a man can feel that way too? A man can feel like he's got a nympho on his hands and he has no time to think. There's nothing more unsexy than somebody trying to love on you when you ain't in the mood. I had no idea you were this old. I think I just ran into some 95-year-old people here. You can say amen if you believe it. Write this down, number three. All men are not the same. Now, from Twitter, and I am on Twitter, I get the impression sometimes that women think men are one way and men think women are another way. All women are not the same. All women do not have the same needs. There are some needs we're born with, some are cultivated, and some are seasonal. Some needs are just seasonal. I remember when I went through a divorce, and there was a girl that worked at TBN, Trinity Broadcasting, for Paula Jan Kraut, and she was a good-looking girl, sexy girl, but her brother became a very close friend. But what fascinated me was she could just quote scriptures all the time. Just everything was a scripture. Everything was a scripture. And I thought, wow, because I'd never been around that. I remember offering my wife $100 if she'd read the Bible that night. I couldn't get her interested in the Word. So when I found a woman fascinated with the Bible, I felt like I had found heaven. This has to be the right woman for me because she loves to read the Bible. She loves to read the Bible. Everything's a scripture. And quote, and quote, and quote, and quote. And because I had never been around a woman like that except my mother, and here's a girl that didn't look like my mother, but she had all this love for the Word of God, and boy, I just came alive. I just came alive. I just, wow, wow. That was a need. That was a need that I had. I needed someone who would talk the Word of God with me. Well, I had buddies that didn't feel that way. They weren't looking for a woman to quote scriptures. They had different desires, different needs. I never tire of the wisdom of God. Wisdom is the ability to recognize difference, right and wrong, evil and righteousness, difference in people, difference in a countenance, difference in a moment, like the blind man crying out to Jesus. The dominant purpose for wisdom. And don't you love the wisdom of God? So thankful you're listening today and watching and being a part of the internet, telling others about it. And I hope you're getting, by the way, I hope you're getting my daily podcast every single day on your iPod or your MP3. Every single day, 2 minutes of wisdom. Be a blessing. Sometimes I go a little over because I get excited. I want you to be a part of this ministry. I believe that when you get involved with God, He gets involved with you. I am one of the ministers of the gospel who believe the words of Jesus. I believe every word He said. When He told Peter that there would be a 100-fold return on any investment in the gospel, in Mark 10, 28 through 30, I believed Him. When the Word of God says in Malachi 3, that if I bring the tithe, which is 10% of my income, and the offering back to Him, that He would open the windows of heaven and pour me out a blessing I don't have room enough to receive, I believe Him. Why would I believe God about heaven and hell and not believe Him about the blessing of the Lord? I want to pray over the seeds that you have been planting in this ministry. And by the way, I have an incredible gift you're going to love. In fact, it's probably one of the greatest gifts I've ever offered. We're asking the Holy Spirit for 300 partners this week who will set aside a seed of $300 for our outreaches. I need your help. I want you to help me. Not just to feed 1,000 children a day, which we do, or 1,000 families, or underwrite the Wisdom of Asia Bible College, or to underwrite the tent factory in South Africa, or the Home of Hope, but that we can go into 100 countries with the gospel. I'm holding in my hand the Wisdom Quick Scan Bible. The Wisdom Quick Scan Bible. I have never in my life found a Bible easier to read. As you know, for many years, I've read the Bible through 40 chapters a day every single month of my life. There is no easier book to read than this Quick Scan Bible. When I found out that I could offer it to you inside of some of the teaching that I've been doing and I'll do today, I want you to have it. Call me right now, plant your seed of 300, and watch God move. So all men are not the same. Every man has a different focus. Every man has a different database. Every man comes from different experiences. And the fourth thing that I wish every woman would know about a man is that every man is running from a painful memory. If you know a man's worst memories, you can interpret his conduct and his behavior. Every man has a memory he is running from. It may be the memory of a father who called him stupid, he'll never amount to anything, or a father who knocked him around. And a man has a great, great database. And only when he trusts a woman, now every man trusts a woman. Proverbs 31 says that what makes her different is the man can safely trust in her. Men need to trust a woman so bad, they don't even give it time to prove. Men like to think they can discern women, which is man's worst mistake. There is no greater mistake any male ever makes than to think he can read a woman. Now, a woman knows that, and she works with that stupid in that man. Every woman knows that a man cannot discern worth a dime when it comes to females. He's just off. We've seen the greatest people in the world, the smartest people in the world, look at Solomon, wise everywhere except with woman. Because a man's brain just shuts off when he gets around a woman. I want to say this. Men trust quickly. They don't talk quickly, but they trust quickly. A man will confess quicker than any woman. Look at the book. Look where Samson and Delilah. Did he break down or did she break down? He broke down. Tough. The anointing doesn't make you smart. It makes you responsive to the presence of God. It doesn't make you bright. Some of the most anointed people on the earth are among the most stupid. You have Samson that was anointed and had a grace upon his life. But when it came to a woman, men want to trust, men need to trust, and men will trust. One of the things I wish every woman knew was that a man is in constant pursuit of his uniqueness. A man is in constant pursuit of what makes him unlike others. It's a constant thing to a man. Man has the nature of the predator. He's not the prey. He wants to reach. He wants to pursue. He has a need to conquer. He's a man. I remember my mother telling us boys, you'll never be the man your father is. And that stayed with me, and it registered. And it was years and years and years before I realized I didn't have to pray 4 hours a day for God to accept me. It was years. It was many years. Because the woman I loved and trusted, my mother, felt like my daddy had something that none of us boys had in us. So we were looking for uniqueness. My older brother John was chosen by a famous movie star as the most handsome in his class, the most handsome in his school. So he walked around as Mr. Handsome. I never got Mr. Handsome in my school. And I used to think, wow, just once. But it never happened to me. So I looked for other ways to find my uniqueness. Daddy had the spiritual side to him. He and God talked for hours. My brother had the good-looking, you know, part. They all thought he looked like Clint Eastwood, my older brother at the time. And all these kind of things. And so I began to realize, wow, where's my uniqueness? And a man wants to hear about his difference from other men. Oh, I like your hair. Well, there's a lot of good-looking hair. Oh, I like your nose. But he's looking for what makes you enjoy him above others. What makes you enjoy him? So when your husband comes in from a Sunday night service, Sister Kathy, he didn't really want to hear, didn't you like what Dr. Mike said? He really couldn't care less. He wants to hear from you, baby, what the way that you transitioned in that service was really of the Lord. I love the way you transitioned that service. You don't want to hear from him, I wish you would change your hair to look like Sister so-and-so. You ever notice her hair? I try to get your hair, because you're going to think, you know, he secretly wants her. He wants me to role play tonight. You don't want to hear that. I don't know of a woman in this place that wants to hear her man admire some woman walking by. Wow, wonder who she is. Does that excite you? Oh, I can't wait to get you home, honey, since you. No. You turn cold inside, don't you? The last thing you want to hear. There was a girl I was very interested in one time, and she ended up marrying a famous friend of mine, an athlete. But we went out a couple of times. I'll never forget, my magazine had come out, and so she came up by my house, and I said, here's my new magazine, Wisdom. And she flipped past my page, past the next page. And remember Conrad Hula, young protege? She went to his page and started reading it. I said, aren't you going to read what I wrote? She said, I always read what you wrote. And, of course, that date ended in about 15 minutes. I wish you understood the passion a man has. Not to be bragged on, but to be valued. And I know the difference between compliments and someone who values. There's a difference between a 40-year-old man and a 2-year-old child. And there's a difference between a 65-year-old man and a 40-year-old man. I called some of my guys in a few weeks ago. One was 26, one was 32. And I said, how do you guys feel? Do you feel like you're smarter than this 4-year-old little boy over here? And they all say, yeah, you're a lot smarter. I said, now that's the way I feel around you. I said, these extra 30 years on my life has an impact on me. And so whatever you're doing, think this. I've walked through some of that, so I'm going to look at it differently. When I mentioned that I wish every woman knew that men were different, that means you've got to react to a man according to his difference. React to a man according to his difference. know who you're talking to. Ladies, know who you're talking to. Almost inevitably, a woman that has three or four kids, when she starts dating a guy, she starts talking to him like he's kid number five. You can be around your children so long that you think others are just an add-on. I stopped a girl one time I was dating, and I said, I think you've mixed me up with your little boy, because I ain't your little boy. I wish every woman knew how to ask questions a man wants to answer. I wish every woman asked questions that a man wants to answer. That'll take thought, because great questions take a lot of thought. What was the fascination of Queen Sheba? How do you impact a man like Solomon, who's got so many women? How do you make a difference? It wasn't her $4 million present she bought, because that was like paying for his water pots. It wasn't a 9-month trip on camels, because kings from all over the world sought access to him. But when the Queen of Sheba came into his presence, she said, the half of everything told me about you was not even close. And the Bible said she asked him questions after questions. Do you think the questions was, well, Solomon, how much you pay for this chair? Oh, I like this wife. Where'd you get tablecloth? That's nice. Oh, I like flowers. Or if you're like some I've been with, I don't like fake flowers. She knew the questions that made him feel valued. To a man, his opinion is law. A man doesn't consider his opinion to be an option introduced to your world. He considers his opinion to be the final analysis. How do you tell a man that thinks he's always right? Would you want to marry a man who always thought he was wrong? No. I wish a woman knew how to introduce a change of opinion. And it's very simple. Baby, you mentioned this. Here's another possible thought. Tell me if you think it's worth anything. Here's another way to do it. Which is your choice? Which is your favorite? A man wants to be God to his woman. A man wants to be God to his woman. And every time you destroy his sense of confidence, he shuts down another room and never will let you in that room again. Some women take a king and they slice him and slice him and slice him until he feels like a peasant. And then they wonder why he strays and goes down the road. He's going to go where somebody feels like his opinion matters. Doesn't justify it. I'm just telling you that happens. That happens. I have much more, and I'll give it to you maybe Sunday, tomorrow. But thank you for letting me share these few moments with you. And Pastor Monica. Did you get some notes?
Yes, sir. I actually recorded the entire teaching.
She recorded it so she could use it against me or play it for your guy when he comes along.
Yes, sir. Both.
Both. I want to just pray over your life. A woman has phenomenal impact on a man. No woman I know accurately assesses her potential in the life of a man. No woman I know has any concept. If a man begins to put confidence in you, protect it, shield it. And every man is longing for one woman who won't lie. Just one. Hey, just one. Just one woman who won't lie or make him lose his manhood. And it's going to be vital that you understand God's given you great strength with a woman, great power with a woman. And honesty is very impactful. To me, integrity is about 10,000 times more important than beauty. Because beauty is so easy to find. Nothing's more replaceable than beauty. Nothing's easier to replace than a good-looking woman. But nothing brings more pleasure to the heart of a man than a woman he can trust. A woman he can trust. I beg of you to be trustworthy. And whoever your man is, if you've been married 20 years, if you've been widowed 2 years, whoever God places close to you, and don't be afraid to be available. Ruth was available. She just didn't stay. She said, I'm here if you want me. She didn't cling and prophesy to him. There's two parts of the gospel that I emphasize repeatedly. The person of Jesus and his principles. One's the law of God, one's the life of God. One's the king, one's the kingdom. The person of Jesus prepares you for eternity. The principles of Jesus prepare you for the earth. You can be ready for heaven, but you can't buy a car because you don't understand the laws of increase, the law of focus, the law of faith. In the 72 laws that I mentioned in our school of wisdom, there's the law of protocol, there's the law of focus, there's the law of reproduction. There's the law, but today I want to talk to you about the law of difference. The law of difference. There's a difference in flowers. There's a difference in trees. There's a difference in nationalities and cultures. God is the creator of difference. Now we know that wisdom is the discovery of difference or the recognition of difference. Difference in a countenance, like Joshua or Joseph when he saw the countenance of the butler and the baker. And he knew they had a problem. He saw and reacted to their difference. The Pharisees did not recognize nor celebrate the difference in Jesus, but Zacchaeus did. Jesus hung between two thieves. One cursed him, but the other one celebrated his difference and said, "Would you remember me? Today you'll be with me in paradise." There was a school of prophets in the Old Testament. But one of them, Elisha, had a difference in his passion. One theologian told me that he actually served Elijah, his mentor, for 22 years. I have not gone into the study of that, but I was stunned that he actually washed his feet for him, washed his clothes in travel. Why? He saw Elijah's difference. And when Elijah was taken up in the whirlwind, the chariot, remember, it was Elisha who received the double portion. And in scripture, Elisha had exactly twice as many miracles as Elijah had in his life. Boaz saw the difference in Ruth. The king saw the difference in Esther. The king saw the difference in Daniel.
Pharaoh saw the difference in Joseph, and in 24 hours went from the prison to being the number two prime minister man all over Egypt. The law of difference. It's important for you to see the difference in others. It's kind of foolish to try to teach a cat to bark because you've got to find the difference in everything around you. Why am I talking to you about this? Most people live a lifetime studying their weakness instead of their difference. Your difference reveals your assignment. Turtles don't talk, trees don't fly. I know the Bible talks about the sound of the turtle dove, but there is a different function for everything. My eyes don't talk, my mouth doesn't hear, my ear doesn't speak. Everything created has a different function. Have you discovered your divine difference? First, let's talk about God's difference from everything else and everybody else. Numbers 23:19, God is not a man that he should lie. God's major difference from humans, he never lies. He is a covenant God. Hath he not spoken it, will he not do it. God's difference in his character, his difference in his integrity, the difference in his power. I love what he told Job when Job got a little cocky and said, if I could find God, I would argue with him. As long as that was his attitude, he couldn't find God. Finally, God said, where were you when I decided to create stars? Where were you when I decided to fling the stars into space and put planets and oceans? Where were you? Because God knew his difference. But you need to know God's difference from others. He's a faithful God. He's a caring God. He's a merciful God. And he's a God with profound expectations. But what is your difference? There are four things I want to bring your attention to. What do you love? What do you love to learn about? What do you love to hear about? What excites you? What energizes you? Number two, what environment do you flourish? In what kind of environment do you flourish? Even Jesus didn't do well in Nazareth. That's why he went to Capernaum. Places matter. Fish that die on the land thrive in the ocean. In what environment does your best come alive? Number three, what do you hate? What makes you mad? Anger is passion. Anger is energy. It just needs the appropriate focus. When Moses saw an Egyptian beating up on an Israelite, an anger rose on him. Is it molested children? Is it battered wives? What makes you mad? Drug addiction? I was watching a movie a few days ago where a man was so angry because his child had, been killed through a drug dealer selling him dope. And he was so angry. MADD, Mothers Against Drunk Driving? That mother who started that organization saw her baby splattered on a pavement, killed because of a drunk driver. That's why she birthed that organization. Your anger is the birthplace for a change and for what makes you cry. What makes you weep? Pay attention to your sadness. Don't try to run away from sadness. Identify the cause of it. It may be something God wants you to heal. God wants you to change. This is my incredible gift of celebrating your seed of $58. Thank you for standing with my ministry. In the 58th chapter of Isaiah, he offers four rewards. So when you plant your seed on button 8, ask for the law of difference, how it can help you succeed, and expect your harvest.
This is another 2-Minute Wisdom Key with Dr. Mike Murdock.
Wisdom Key 300 in a book that I want you to have. Click on button 8, order it. Wisdom Key 300, where you are matters as much as what you are. We talk about the law of place, that God made places before he made people. God tells Jonah, go to Nineveh. He says, no, I'm going to go to Tarshish. A storm comes up. The sailors realize they're going to lose their boat because a man is in the wrong place. Many years ago, a great man of God by the name of David Wilkerson, pastors now, I believe, in New York, wrote the great book, The Cross and the Switchblade. We were coming back from a television interview together, and he starts talking to me. And he says something I never heard. He said, if the finances for my ministry begin to plummet and go down and I begin to have problems, I know that somebody is on my staff out of the will of God, that someone is running from the perfect place God wants them. I couldn't believe what I was hearing, and then I thought of the scriptures. Jonah was in the wrong place, and everybody around him suffered because of it. If you're not in God's plan today, pray. Get back in God's will. God has a place for you. Even Jesus didn't do well in places. That's why he left Nazareth and went to Capernaum. The Bible says that Jesus was in one city and could not do many miracles. God could not be God when there was a place of unbelief and doubt. Where you are matters as much as what you are. You can be a wrong person, like the Samaritan woman, but in the right place at the well with Jesus. The woman who had been caught in the act of adultery, but she was in the right place in the presence of Jesus. Where you are matters as much as what you are. Imagine all hours of the night and day receiving wisdom tweets that God inspires to my heart. I want you to follow me on Twitter. Write this down and follow me today. I never tire of the wisdom of God. Wisdom is the ability to recognize difference, right and wrong, evil and righteousness, difference in people, difference in a countenance, difference in a moment, like the blind man crying out to Jesus. The dominant purpose for wisdom, and don't you love the wisdom of God? So thankful you're listening today and watching and being a part of the internet, telling others about it. And I hope you're getting, by the way, I hope you're getting my daily podcast every single day on your iPod or your MP3, every single day, 2 minutes of wisdom. Be a blessing. Sometimes I go a little over because I get excited. I want you to be a part of this ministry. I believe that when you get involved with God, He gets involved with you. I am one of the ministers of the gospel who believe the words of Jesus. I believe every word He said. When He told Peter that there would be a 100-fold return on any investment in the gospel, in Mark 10, 28 through 30, I believed Him. When the Word of God says in Malachi 3, that if I bring the tithe, which is 10% of my income, and the offering back to Him, that He would open the windows of heaven and pour me out a blessing I don't have room enough to receive, I believe Him. Why would I believe God about heaven and hell and not believe Him about the blessing of the Lord? I want to pray over the seeds that you have been planting in this ministry. And by the way, I have an incredible gift you're going to love. In fact, it's probably one of the greatest gifts I've ever offered. We're asking the Holy Spirit for 300 partners this week who will set aside a seed of $300 for our outreaches. I need your help. I want you to help me. Not just to feed 1,000 children a day, which we do, or 1,000 families, or underwrite the Wisdom of Asia Bible College, or to underwrite the tent factory in South Africa, or the Home of Hope, but that we can go into 100 countries with the gospel. I'm holding in my hand the Wisdom Quick Scan Bible. The Wisdom Quick Scan Bible. I have never in my life found a Bible easier to read. As you know, for many years, I've read the Bible through 40 chapters a day every single month of my life. There is no easier book to read than this Quick Scan Bible. when I found out that I could offer it to you inside of some of the teaching that I've been doing and I'll do today, I want you to have it. Call me right now, plant your seed of 300, and watch God move.